The following podcast is brought to you by the folks at GoodPoliticsRadio.com.
With me is Robert Thomas Ramey. Bob, are you there?
Yeah, Chuck. How are you today?
Good. Thanks for joining us. Tell everybody the name of your book.
Yeah, it's called War and Death of the American Dream, and it's about the cancer that's taken over our government, and it's done it in such a sly, almost Chinese water torture kind of way. You've probably heard that old saying, if you put a frog in the water and you turn it on slowly and slowly warm it up to boil, if you do it slow enough, the frog won't jump out. And that's kind of what I see happening here in America. The people have just been kind of numbed into believing that everything's okay, and it's not.
Years ago, I read the most interesting article in a local newspaper. I don't want to mention names for a number of reasons, but if somebody said off the air, you know, who was it, I'd tell them, okay?
Mm-hmm. Sure, I understand.
All right, but there is a county, or there was a county in Florida where land once upon a time was very reasonable, and people from up north flocked down to the area. They bought little 5-acre pieces of land, and they put a double wide mobile home on it, and they said to themselves, thank God, we're now set for life. We'll be able to live on our Social Security check and get by. There were local stores, and everything was fine. And then what happened was somehow the government changed from local citizens who ran the government at very reasonable yearly wage rates. And somehow the professional government people took over. Now, a lot of people are not aware of the fact that there are organizations in the United States of professional government people at the local and county level that work very, very hard to expand what they call professionalism in government. What that typically means is the job that used to pay $20,000 a year now pays $120,000 a year. And the local guy who used to be the sheriff or used to be this or that has been replaced by somebody who has degrees behind their name, and they're making $100,000, $80,000, whatever. Down at the county courthouse, that person who used to be the supervisor of elections that made $19,000-$20,000 is now making $100,000, and they have a degree after their name. Well, anyhow, what happened is the professional government people somehow got in and took over in this county, and they raised the taxes so high that they started actually putting these retirees out of their homes. That's what's happened to America. In other words, whether it is at the, in many cases, whether it's at the county level, the city level, and especially if it's at the federal level, all of these government workers are all members of the We've Got Ours Club. In other words, I've got mine. I've got my good paycheck. I've got my pension. I've got my health benefits. I am set for life as long as I don't screw up big time. I am set. I've got mine. And then when you come up to their desk to shuffle some papers, they look at you and they think to themselves, that poor slob who's out there trying to bang out a living at $8 an hour, and look at me, I've got it made. And that's what's happened to government across the United States, at the city level, the county level, the state level, and the federal level.
Well, it's so true, Chuck, and it's a crime, and it's, I wish we could somehow motivate the people to realize that. Along those lines, I was talking with a gentleman yesterday, and a bit older than me. He looked to be about maybe early 70s. And he realizes, like you, what's going on with our society and within the government. And he tries to tell his friends that are of a similar age the truth about the government. And he was so frustrated that he was almost shaking with anger, because he said time and again his friends would tell him, hey, look, you know, we've got our house paid off and we're here comfortable and, you know, we take a little vacation now and then, we see the grandkids. But basically, we're going to die before it gets really bad. So everybody else is on their own. And that this is kind of the attitude that these corporate bureaucrats, these professional bureaucrats, that's exactly what they've been aiming for. And then when you add in the group that's, let's say, maybe up to about 25 or so that have been the product of our educational system in the last decade or two, they are likewise just, and you know, kids are generally tend to be a little bit irresponsible, but now they're growing up so ignorant because they're not really taught any history. They're not taught many basic skills, and it seems to me, Chuck, that there's a small segment of the population somewhere from maybe the mid to late 40s to the mid to late maybe 50s or 60s, and that's who we're going to have to count on if we're going to bring back this government, you know, to the people.
Well, I would add to that the 77 million people who are en route to retirement, because they're all in the age bracket where they remember what America used to be. I was talking to Dr. Pat Choate, Ph.D., last hour, and I told him, I said, two weekends ago, Reuters ran a news article, and I think you can find it probably by going to Google and just Google, quote, the death of the American dream, unquote, and then put in Reuters. And the story told about how at the Delphi plant, when Delphi went bankrupt and the employees were told they're going to be paid $10 an hour instead of the 25 or 30, a whole bunch of them, with their union stewards, went to management and said, okay, do you people realize now that with these new wage levels, we will never be able to buy the cars that we're going to be making the parts for? Will never be able to buy those cars. Never. Not at $10 an hour. Ain't no way you're going to buy a Hummer. Ain't no way you're going to buy a new Silverado pickup truck. No way. Just impossible. Robert Thomas Ramey, hang on for a minute. Let me do the timeout on Talkstar. We'll be right back in just 2 minutes.
Welcome to Straight Talk with Dr. Barry Sears. Dr. Sears, no one wants to grow old. What can I do?
The aging process itself is one of increasing inflammation. If we want to turn back the hands of time, we have to reduce inflammation in our brain, our heart, and our immune system. And the best way to do that is by taking adequate levels of pharmaceutical-grade fish oil, rich in omega-3 fatty acids, things like Omega-RX. If you take only one supplement to reverse the aging process, this should be it.
The best way to add essential omega-3 fatty acids to your diet is by supplementing with Dr. Barry Sears' ultra-potent, ultra-clean, pharmaceutical-grade Omega-RX fish oil. To order your fish oil today, call 800-962-0123, 800-962-0123, or visit cleanfishoil.com. Call now for Omega-RX fish oil, 800-962-0123, or visit cleanfishoil.com today.
If you've got kids, chances are sooner or later you're going to need dental help. And when you do, I hope you'll remember 1995dental.com. 1995dental.com tells you how to save about 50% on braces for your kids, similar savings on other services. Because this isn't insurance, there is no waiting period, no exclusion, no claim forms to fill out. You get instant savings from tens of thousands of dentists coast to coast. Unlike a lot of insurance policies, this discount program covers cosmetic dentistry, bonding, and cleaning. For the individual, it's $11.95 a month. But for the entire family, everyone who lives under your roof, regardless of age or relationship, it's $19.95 a month. Hence our name, 1995dental.com. Type in the numbers 1995, then the word dental.com. 1995 dental.com will save you.
Robert Thomas Ramey with us. Say the name of the book again.
Yeah, War and Death of the American Dream, and it's available at my website, uniteamericanow.com.
Bob, let me ask you this question, and I get asked this off the air mostly. People say, you know, what we really need is a third party. And it is my humble belief that we could have had a third party had Ross Perot not dropped out when he did. I believe, in my opinion, Ross Perot broke the heart of America, and in my opinion, he probably killed the third party movement for generations.
You know, I can't prove the statement I'm about to make, Chuck, but I have it on good authority that Ross Perot dropped out simply because he was threatened. His family, more specifically, was threatened. His success was something that neither party wanted to deal with, and that the group above the political parties, the global elite, as I call them in my book, realized that if they let him get going, he had the power to take back this government from the toxic cancer that has overrun it. And I've heard that from a couple of sources, that his family was very literally threatened. And so, you know, I agree with you. He broke a lot of people's hearts, and I still hear people talk about today about Ross Perot. I've recently uncovered a quote. I'm one of those, I love to find quotes. And here's one by a gentleman who has passed away. You'll recognize the name. And needless to say, he had a lot of his own personal problems and personal issues. But here's the quote. The individual is handicapped by coming face to face with a conspiracy so monstrous he cannot believe it exists. The man who made that statement knew the U.S. government probably better than anybody who's ever lived. His name is J. Edgar Hoover. And so people want to believe that the government is good, Chuck, and I think it is just, for many people, it is hard for them to believe it. And then I think the lazy factor comes into play, that, you know, oh, well, you know, what can I do? I'm a single individual. And then they get disheartened, despondent, frustrated. And that's why we're up against it today, and that's why I think that the time is short, because they're giving us the you know, they're rushing the gold line, because I think that one world government is in sight. I think they can smell it. I think they can taste it. And the plan that President Bush put forth in March of this year, when he met with Fox and Martin from Mexico and Canada, which was that we all become one big Homeland Security Association of the Americas, I think. And they want to do that within 5 years. By 2010, they want us to be one big, large, global, happy family, and I'm scared, Chuck.
Well, okay, regarding Ross Perot, right before Ross Perot dropped out, the day before, he flew to New York City, and he had a meeting with a number of New York bankers, whose names I know. He then returned to Dallas, and he immediately dropped out. And it is my opinion that what you said earlier is probably rather correct. He was told in no uncertain way by these people that if you continue doing what you're doing, there is no way that anybody will be able to guarantee the safety of you and your family. And that is what I think happened. That's my personal opinion, to which I'm entitled. But I have enough collateral information to believe that that did happen. Next on the list is the globalization. I'm finding some strange things happening. If you read, I spend 4 or 5 hours a day reading news wires. Europe, as you know, has decided to back off on the European Union. There's even talks of some countries starting to issue their own currency again instead of the euro. They are also getting really fed up with the radical Muslims, and I'm talking about country after country after country in Europe, really getting fed up with the radical Muslims and the Muslims in general, who are trying to tell them how to run their country, and they're only 10% of the population or less. So I think we're seeing a bit of an awakening by people, and I've talked to people from Canada who just simply say, hey, we're not interested in becoming a state of the United States. And they're realizing that this is what is trying to be done, and they don't particularly like it. So I think there is an awakening of some degree.
I hope you're right, because I think that it bodes well for America. I remember when the French and maybe the Dutch, I think it was, that voted against it when it came up for ratification. Unfortunately, what I did also read was that the EU, kind of the head, was going ahead kind of anyway, perpetuating its own agenda, almost not taking that into consideration. So I would love nothing more than to see, you know, France or Germany or Holland begin to issue their currencies and start to dismantle the EU, because it is the formula, if you will, that they want to apply to Canada, Mexico, and America.
Well, I find it fascinating that while Mexico is so, they have a number of movements where they're trying to find a way to retake California, Arizona, and Texas. You know that.
Yes.
But the fascinating thing about Mexico is what people never say. First of all, people ought to call up the Mexican consulate and find out what the rules are if you want to just simply retire in Mexico. You got to put up a cash bond. You got to prove income. You got to prove that you won't be a burden to Mexico. You'll never own property, and you'll never vote. That's the rule if you want to move to Mexico and be a resident and retire there. However, on the other side of the coin, they just want the border open so that anybody from Mexico can walk in and then stand in line for food stamps and welfare here in America and free hospital care. However, on Mexico's southern border, it's a much different issue. They literally have troops stationed every so many feet on their southern border, and if somebody tries to get into Mexico on Mexico's southern border, most likely they're going to wind up with an ounce of lead in their body or two. And they're going to be very, very dead and stiff and cold. Or they're going to be shot at and they're going to run back to to where they came from. But they're not going to get into Mexico, because Mexico guards her southern border like we should be guarding our southern border. Except nobody in the press wants to ever talk about it, because, gee, that might be the truth, and it might tip everybody off as to what Mexico really is thinking about. They don't want the trouble from the south coming up into their country, but they sure don't mind coming to America and getting everything they can for free and then sending the money back home to Mexico. That's just not going to keep working, folks. Can't happen forever. We'll be right back. Hang on.
It's bad enough if you suffer asthma, but as a parent, the agony of watching your child struggling for breath must be agony beyond measure. What if there was a natural, effective, drug-free answer to asthma? You'd want to know, wouldn't you? Well, I've been reading up on a little-known clinical trial at a major hospital that suggests you can be rid of asthma symptoms, and sinus and allergy symptoms to breathe easily, calmly, and in a more natural, relaxed way. It's guaranteed, or you get your money back, and you've got 90 days to decide. Look it up for yourself online at healthstarproducts.com. HEALTH, healthstarproducts.com. You've got 90 days to decide if this program works for you. If it doesn't, you get your money back. Go to www.healthstarproducts.com.
You shall have rings on your fingers and bells on your toes, and you shall have Chuck Carter wherever you go. Well, it doesn't exactly rhyme, nor is it grammatically correct. But it gets the point over that the Chuck Carter Show is now available on demand on iPod. To find out how to get the Chuck Carter Show anytime, anywhere on iPod, go to ChuckCarterShow.com. That's on the internet, www.ChuckCarterShow.com. And get the information on how to get Chuck Carter on demand on iPod. The Chuck Carter Show on iPod is brought to you in cooperation with Good Politics Radio and Talkstar Radio Network. Yes, now you can listen to Chuck Carter anytime, anywhere on iPod. Go to www.chuckcartershow.com to find out how to iPod.
Robert Thomas Ramey is with us. So that said, Bob, I don't know what we're going to do to save the nation. I talked to all of these economists who are even pro-free trade, and I asked them, I said, maybe you can tell me, how are we ever going to pay back the money that we're borrowing from other nations, like the $2 billion a day we borrow from Red China? How are we going to pay them back? How are we going to earn money as a nation and pay these people back? And do you know not one of these economists can answer that question?
Well, I don't think that they want to tell you the truth, Chuck, because I think they know the truth, and that's inflation. At some point, the only alternative is going to be to start firing up those printing presses already faster. And at some point, the people of the other countries that buy our debt, $2 billion a day, are going to look at us and are going to laugh and start selling their dollars. And by then, it's going to be too late, and the American people are going to see some financial heartache that I think will make the Great Depression pale. By the way, just let me back up for a second and say, God bless you for telling the truth in that statement that you made before we went to break, because I believe if the nightly news and if the cable news companies of this country would be honest and fair and give you 5 or 10 minutes just to make the case that you just made, and the American people could hear it, I think that they would start to see the light and realize, my God, we're being taken for saps and suckers, because just because we want to enforce our laws, they're calling us racists. But they don't know the truth, and the media is doing everything they can to stifle the truth. So God bless you for that. And as far as our economy, I think the poor American middle class is about to be decimated beyond recognition, and that's why they're trying to flood us with illegal aliens, because that's the lever. And they've institutionalized socialism and welfare so that, you know, you can collect $4, $5, $6 an hour, and then you don't want to go to work, you know, and take minimum wage, because you get just about that same thing sitting home doing nothing. I think the economists know, and I think they're just afraid to say, Chuck.
I was talking to a number of people who have lost their jobs, and they were on unemployment, okay?
Mm-hmm.
And I said to one gentleman, he had had a pretty good job, and his unemployment check was $275 a week. And we were talking, and I said to him, I said, Ted, can you find within 30 miles of where you live a job that will allow you to take home $275 a week? And he said, no. I've looked. I've gone everywhere I can to find a job that will allow me to take home $275 a week, and he said, I can't find it.
That's scary. What part of the country is he in, Chuck?
We're talking about northern Florida.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, there was a big news thing that the steel company is you know, just I saw it yesterday or the day before that the new core steel is just begging for what you said, fair trade, not free trade. You see, and this is the misnomer that our politicians have keep saying, oh, free trade will save us.
Yeah,
free
trade
will save us. But it's not free. It's completely unfair.
All right, give out your website quick. We're out of time.
UniteAmericaNow.com, Chuck. UniteAmericaNow.com. And Chuck, thank you again and good luck.
Take care. Good luck. God bless you and your loved ones, all those who have suffered through the storms and our troops in harm's way. If you'd like to be in touch with us, it's For the People, P.O. Box 150, P.O. Box 150, Tampa, Florida, 33601. The website, ChuckCarterShow.com, ChuckCarterShow.com, or ChuckCarter.com. God bless you and God bless America. Aloha.
The views expressed on this podcast do not necessarily represent the views of the folks at GoodPoliticsRadio.com. We welcome your comments about this podcast and would like to hear from you. For Good Politics Radio, this is Don Llewellyn. Thanks for listening.